Hey there guys, my name is Holly and this is the Women Series, an educational platform designed to empower women. Today, we are going to be discussing why preconceptive care is so important, not just for the outcome of a healthy pregnancy and birth, but particularly for the outcome of a healthy baby. Now, a lot of people often say to me, well, I know blah, blah person, and they weren't healthy, and they have a healthy kid, and they got pregnant easily. Yes, those scenarios do happen, although I would probably bet that their child isn't as healthy as they could be. Maybe they are dealing with neurodevelopmental issues such as ADD, OCD, tantrums, maybe that child has eczema, maybe that child has gut issues. You know, on the surface, somebody can look healthy, but you don't really ever know what's happening behind closed doors. However, yes, that scenario can happen, but it's not something that we should try and model our own pregnancy and fertility journey on. The reason I would say not to model your fertility journey on those scenarios where somebody has conceived and given birth to a child without ever caring about their health is because we know from a research standpoint how important both paternal and maternal health is when it comes to ensuring the health of our offspring. I'm going to give you an example. A lot of the time, women will go into their fertility journey with reproductive health issues. The best example of this is polycystic ovarian syndrome, which ultimately is a metabolic disorder, but accounts for up to 11% of all infertility cases. Now, what's the issue with conceiving if you have PCOS? I would say that if you are conceiving without actually dealing with your health condition before that conception point, so in this example, we're talking about PCOS, all of the metabolic issues that come with that health condition will impact your baby in both utero, but also as they are born. We know with PCOS, there is inflammation involved, there is blood sugar mismanagement involved, and there's also excess testosterone involved. These three factors have been shown to negatively impact the health of your baby. For example, we know that excess testosterone in the mother while pregnant has been shown to negatively impact the reproductive health of a female baby in utero. That is a fact. So if we go into pregnancy with PCOS that we haven't bothered to deal with, then we are potentially negatively impacting our baby girl's fertility when she becomes an adult and wants to have children herself. We also know that if you are inflamed, which definitely, if you are dealing with PCOS, there's a level of inflammation involved, but many, many, many health conditions are attributable to inflammation. That can certainly negatively impact the development of your offspring, in particular, their brain development in trimester one and trimester two. And we know that in trimester one, if there is what's called failure of neuronal migration taking place in the baby's brain, this is where we start to see autism and dyslexia develop. So taking care of your health going into baby making, this whole preconceptive space is not just about going from good to great. It's about potentially removing the risks of all of these different health issues we're starting to see in children, and you are in the driving seat of that. Now, I mentioned maternal health and I used the example of PCOS, but we also know that paternal health plays a huge role, and particularly in that preconceptive zone for men, getting their sperm into a good, healthy position is vital at ensuring that that baby that's created with that sperm isn't actually having any epigenetic issues from unhealthy sperm. Unhealthy sperm would be sperm that has low sperm count, poor morphology, poor motility. Maybe your partner has low testosterone. These are things that you want to deal with before ever considering trying to have a baby. Now, I've used both the male health and the female health example, but how does this actually translate into an issue in our children, but also as they become adults? Well, a great example is lip ties. Now, there's a lot of theories out there that lip ties are developed in utero, and it is a byproduct of the excessive amount of endocrine disrupting chemicals we are now exposed to while pregnant. This theory suggests that these chemicals are changing the way that our palate forms. Also, we know that nutritional deficiencies during pregnancy, such as vitamin A, can certainly lead to palate, you know, dysfunction and issues with how the mouth is formed. If your baby has a lip tie or a tongue tie for that matter, and it goes unnoticed, which is a very common scenario, that baby may not latch well at birth. And in this instance, if a child isn't latching well, a lot of the time that mother is going to be in pain while she's trying to breastfeed. And usually if she is not supported in those initial couple of days or weeks of her breastfeeding journey, there's a huge drop off of breastfeeding if it's too troublesome. Now we know, and I know this is a very unpopular opinion, but the research is very, very clear that breastfed babies have better health outcomes than formula fed babies. This is due to the immunoglobulins present, the essential fatty acids present, and a whole host of other things that are present in breast milk that you cannot get out of formula. We also know that breastfed babies have better palates than formula-fed babies because the sucking of the nipple is not something that can be replicated with a bottle. So we've got a scenario here where your baby has developed a lip tie because maybe you were nutritionally deficient going into your pregnancy. Maybe you were dealing with underlying metabolic health issues that have caused that nutritional deficiency. Potentially you were using products or you were exposed to a lot of endocrine disrupting chemicals during a pregnancy. Now your child has a lip tie, they can't breastfeed properly. You make the decision to stop breastfeeding them and you move them onto formula. Now we know that the usage of formula and the lack of usage of breast milk can impact the immune system. And this is where those children might start to develop some level of immune dysregulation, as well as the fact that their microbiome may become a bit disrupted. Now, I haven't even mentioned, what was your birth like? Did you have a vaginal birth or a C-section birth? Because that will also add to the load of a good microbiome or a not so great microbiome. And your microbiome and your child's microbiome is vital for their immune development and their overall health. So you can start to see that one thing then leads to another. The other thing to keep in mind with lip ties is they cause mouth breathing. And when a child is mouth breathing, they become hypoxic, which means that they lack oxygen to the brain. Now, when we don't have oxygen, glucose, and stimulation going to the brain, this is where we could potentially start to develop some neurodevelopmental issues, such as ADD, OCD. On the very far end of the spectrum, autism, dyslexia. Now, I'm not making the bold statement that a lip tie is what causes ADD, but I want you to recognize how important that preconceptive period is and ensuring that your child isn't dealing with these structural issues. They're not dealing with, you know, a failure of neuronal migration in trimester one because there's too much inflammation present. They're not dealing with nutritional deficiencies that are going to cause other health issues, because you have done the work prior to becoming pregnant. And so to finish off this video, I just hope this highlights that when you hear stories of somebody becoming pregnant who didn't give a shit about their health, that's not something to strive for, and it's not something to lean on. In fact, that's a really self-sabotagey way to say, well, I can't be bothered to do the work. But trust me, you putting in the work in your preconceptive period will pay dividends when it comes to the health of your child. And we know if you look at the statistics of children's neurodevelopmental issues, children's gut issues, even children's cancers are skyrocketing. And this cannot be because we're just unlucky as a species. This surely is a byproduct and a reflection of our health in general, inflammation, metabolic health, our exposure to endocrine disrupting chemicals, our stress levels, and everything else that plays a role in the health of both ourselves and our children. Hopefully this video has created a bit of a thought bubble for you. If you want to hear more, you can always jump onto my Instagram where I talk about this stuff quite a lot, but also my Find Your Fertility course where I go through in detail all of the different reproductive health issues both women and men may face and what to do about them before trying to have a baby. You can grab the link in my bio, and I'll be back next week with more information.